involved in the mechanism of action of aminoglycosides. The clinical use of aminoglycosides, they are active against the gram-negative bacteria, especially those bacteria which become drug resistant. So if there is a need to overcome the drug resistant, aminoglycoside is prescribed. Along with this, they have also significance that with the combination of beta-lactam which inhibit the cell wall synthesis like penicillin, along with the beta-lactam antibiotic, they also can be used for the inhibition of gram-positive pathogens. Itself, they are inhibit gram-negative bacteria, but along with the beta-lactam, they can inhibit gram-positive bacteria as well. So providing a broad spectrum antibacterial activity. Penicillin and aminoglycoside combination also are used to achieve a bacterial serum activity to completely kill the bacteria, to completely cure the disease. This combination is useful to treat enterococcal endocarditis and to reduce the therapy against staphylococcal endocarditis, inflammation of endocardium. Resistance can also occur against the aminoglycosides. Now, why resistance occurs against aminoglycosides? Bacteria can produce resistance against aminoglycosides by the production of transferase enzyme. Now, these transferase enzyme can modify the drug. Transferase enzyme can modify the drug by transferring a specific group, like transferring the adenyl group, by the reaction of adenylation, by acetylation or phosphorylation. So transferase causes the conversion of active aminoglycoside into inactive aminoglycoside by the transferring of a specific. Another mechanism which bacteria follow is the impaired entry of the aminoglycoside into the cell. I told you that aminoglycoside enter into the cell with the help of porin proteins, which are present on the plasma on the outer membrane of the bacteria. So if porin protein become mutated, if porin protein become abnormal because of mutation or deletion, it may lead to impaired porin protein. As a result, aminoglycoside cannot enter into the cell. Third one is the aminoglycoside bind to the 30S ribosome. There must be a receptor. So the receptor protein of the 30S ribosomal subunit may be deleted or altered as a result of a mutation. Right? So by altering the receptor, by altering the porin protein, and by altering the drug itself, the bacteria produces resistance against aminoglycosides. Okay? Aminoglycosides have a ring structure, have a polyhydroxyl group, so they are hydrophilic. They are hydrophilic in nature and they are polycationic. They have a charge. So, because of this two characteristics, they are polar and they are polycationic, so they cannot adequately absorb through the stomach. So, they cannot be used. Administered through oral route of administration. So aminoglycosides are given through the parenteral route, like IV or intravenous, intramuscular or intraperitoneal. Aminoglycosides are usually administered intravenously as a 30 to 60 minute infusions. But neomycin, which is one of the aminoglycosides, their parenteral route is prohibited because they are highly toxic. They are highly toxic if administered parenterally. So their use is restricted for the topical use only for the skin infections. Neomycin. Aminoglycosides, they are hydrophilic, so they can easily distribute through every tissue of the body, and they produce the concentration of the amino glycoside produce subtherapeutic effect. Means they produce therapeutic effect below the prescribed drug, below the prescribed dose of the amino glycoside. जिस डोज पे उसे थेरेपी करनी चाहिए उससे कम ही डोज पर वो अपना इफेक्ट प्रोड्यूस करना शुरू कर देगा. दिस मैकेनिज्म इज कॉल्ड एज सब थेरेप्यूटिक इफेक्ट. लो डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन इन द फैटी टिश्यू. सो अमाइनो ग्लाइकोसाइड आर द डोज ऑफ द अमाइनो ग्लाइकोसाइड डिपेंड अपॉन द लीन बॉडी मास नॉट द एक्चुअल बॉडी मास. ओके, कंसंट्रेशन इन द सीएसएफ इज इनएडिक्वेट. द इंट्राथीकल रूट may be utilized. So they can, the amino glycoside cannot enter into the CSF. So if there is infection in the CSF or nervous system, then amino glycoside should be administered through intrathecal route of the administration directly into the spinal cord. They can easily cross the placental barrier. Also they can accumulate in the fetal plasma and amniotic fluid. Amino glycoside, 90% of amino glycoside excreted unchanged. They cannot metabolize in the body. They can be excreted out without any change. And accumulation occur in the patient in the renal dysfunction. So if patient suffers from any renal diseases, so care should be taken while at, prescribing the amino glycosides. Right? Because they uses the passage of renal function. Ototoxicity. Amino glycoside, as they can penetrate every tissue, they can accumulate in the endolymph and perilymph of the inner layer. So once they accumulate in the endolymph and perilymph of the inner layer, they can produce deafness. So they can produce auditory disturbance. But it is occurring at a very high concentration. So high peak plasma level, and the if there is a long duration of the treatment, then it can accumulate in the endolymph and perilymph of the inner ear, which may lead to deafness. And this deafness may be irreversible. Right? So this deafness is irreversible and has been known to affect developing fetuses because they can cross the placenta barrier. Amino glycoside can produce some allergic reactions. Like contact dermatitis is a common reaction to topical applied neomycin. Itself they produce some other reaction. Besides curing the disease, they produce some other skin infections. Nephrotoxicity, because they are excreting throughout the urine, so nephrotoxicity is possible. Means the disturbance in the nephron. Retention in the proximal tubular disrupts the calcium mediated transport processes. So calcium mediated transport processes become disrupted, which may lead to the nephrotoxicity. This results in kidney damage ranging from mild reversible renal impairment to severe potentially irreversible renal failure. Okay, neuromuscular paralysis. This adverse effect means neurons which are controlling the muscles become paralyzed. This is adverse effect is associated with a rapid increase in concentration. Low duration par aap high amount dete hain. If for example high doses infused over a short period, it may lead to the disturbance in the neurons which controlling the muscles, which may lead to paralysis. Or concurrent administration with neuromuscular blockers. If amino glycosides are administered along with the neuromuscular blocker, they also lead to the paralysis. Okay. The amino glycosides, important amino glycosides include streptomycin, neomycin, kanamycin, amikacin, gentamicin, clobramycin, sisomycin, and that they are missing. So we will discuss some important of them. Streptomycin is a very commonly used aminoglycoside. Streptomycin was isolated from this strain of Streptomyces gracilis. Streptomyces gracilis, but against this drug, most of the bacteria has become resistant. Streptomycin particularly used for the treatment of tuberculosis and non-tuberculosis infection. Tuberculosis mycobacterial infection, streptomycin is the main treatment for mainly prescribed for the treatment of tuberculosis and in combination with other agents to prevent emergence of the resistance. Okay, so to overcome the resistance of the streptomycin is given along with other antibiotic to overcome the problem of resistance. Besides the tuberculosis, streptomycin is also used for the treatment of Lagu, which is caused by the Yersinia pestis, tularemia, bacterium caused by the bacterium Prenzilla tularensis, and brucellosis, which is caused by the genus Brucella. Okay, these are the specific type of bacterial infection in which most common symptom is the high chill, fever, pain, and lymph node inflammation of the lymph nodes. Penicillin plus streptomycin is effective for the enterococcal endocarditis. I told you that the combination of beta-lactam and aminoglycoside is important for the treatment of endocarditis. Gentamicin, which is isolated from Micromonas spora pulparia, it is a broad spectrum antibiotic. It can inhibit the growth of gram positive as well as gram negative bacteria. In vitro, it can inhibit the growth of staphylococci and polyporum and some other gram negative bacteria. Synergistic companion with the beta lactam. So if gentamicin is given along with the beta lactam, what is happening? Beta-lactam plus gentamicin, they produce effect against gram-negative rods. Those gram-negative rods which may become resistant against some antibiotics. Okay, beta-lactam and gentamicin is useful to reduce the drug resistance. Gentamicin is the first choice of aminoglycosides because they are low cost and reliable activity and long experience of the use. Gentamicin is used in the creams, ointment, and solution for the treatment of infected burn, wounds, and skin lesions and to prevent intravenous catheter infections. They are used in the infected burns, endocarditis, meningitis, pneumonia, urinary tract infection, skin, eye, and ear infection. Hardaric infection is a cure over it. Meningitis caused by the gram-negative bacteria has been treated with the intrathecal infection of gentamicin sulfate because they cannot enter into CSF. So intrathecal route of administration is given to treat the meningitis. Okay? Tobramycin, which is third aminoglycoside, antibacterial spectrum is similar to gentamicin, means it is also a broad spectrum antibiotic active against gram negative as well as gram positive bacteria. Besides this, it is also effective against pseudomonas infection, bacteremia, infection of the blood, bacterial infection of the blood, osteomyelitis, infection in the bones, pneumonia, ophthalmic ointment and solution. Okay, so if there is an infection in the eye, then tobramycin drops which having the tobramycin is given to the patient. Neomycin and kanamycin both are related aminoglycosides. Drug of the neomycin group are active against gram-positive and gram-negative bacteria and some mycobacteria. So this is also a broad spectrum antibiotic. Neomycin and kanamycin are now limited to topical and oral use because of their high toxicity. They cannot be used parenteral through parenteral route. Neomycin is used to decrease the risk of infection after certain intestinal surgeries. They can be given parenteral but in extreme use. Like for example, it can be given after surgery to reduce the intestinal infection. Similarly, neomycin can suppress the intestinal flora in hepatic coma. Right? So in extreme case, neomycin and kanamycin can be given parenteral, but usually they are not given parenterally. Their topical use is more common. Topically used in skin, eye, ear infection, burn, wounds, and ulcers. Amikacin is a semi-synthetic derivative of kanamycin. It is a very useful drug because it reduces the toxicity of kanamycin. Kanamycin cannot be given parenterally. So kanamycin is modified into amikacin, and amikacin has reduced toxicity as compared to kanamycin. Second important is that it is resistant to many enzymes that inactivate gentamicin and tobramycin. The enzyme transferase, which causes the inactivation of aminoglycosides. Amikacin is resistant against that enzyme, transferase enzyme, which causes adenylation, phosphorylation, and acetylation. Right? So, amikacin is resistant to the enzyme which inactivate gentamicin and tobramycin, and therefore can be used against some microorganism which are resistant against gentamicin and tobramycin. Amikacin is also a broadest antibacterial, having a antibacterial activity against gram-positive as well as gram-negative bacteria. Similar to gentamicin, tobramycin uses. तो आपके जितने भी इसके uses थे, gentamicin, tobramycin is similar for the amikacin. Amikacin has a specialty because they can act against mycobacterium tuberculosis and atypical mycobacteria in AIDS patients. Metolide. So before going into the next class, up till now we have discussed tetracycline, lacylcycline, and aminoglycosides. These three and protein inhibitor binds with the 30S ribosome. Now remaining antibiotic protein inhibitor, which we will discuss in the upcoming slides, these antibiotic bind with 30S ribosomes. So 50S. But we just go 50S ribosomal RNA. Now just have an overview of these.
Several types of antibiotics inhibit bacterial protein synthesis. The 70S bacterial ribosome, which is composed of 30S and 50S subunits, is sufficiently different from the 80S ribosomes of eukaryotes to make it a target for selective toxicity. Most antibiotics bind either to the 30S or the 50S subunit of the ribosome, thereby interfering with protein synthesis. Aminoglycosides such as streptomycin bind to a protein in the 30S ribosomal subunit and interfere by inhibiting protein synthesis and causing misreading of the mRNA. Different aminoglycosides bind to different target proteins on the 30S ribosomal subunit. These antibiotics distort the ribosome so that misreading of the code in mRNA occurs and protein synthesis cannot continue. Bacteria can become resistant to aminoglycosides by mutation of the target ribosomal protein. The tetracyclines inhibit protein synthesis by binding to the 30S ribosomal subunit and inhibiting the binding of aminoacyl tRNA to the A site. In contrast to streptomycin, they do not stop the ribosome on the mRNA, but distort the ribosome so that the incoming aminoacyl tRNA can no longer bind properly to the A site. Bacteria become resistant to tetracyclines by developing an efflux mechanism that removes the tetracyclines from the cell. Some utilize a protein that binds to the ribosome and prevents binding of tetracyclines, and some strains of Bacteroides become resistant by chemically modifying the tetracycline so that it does not interfere with protein synthesis. Erythromycin, a macrolide antibiotic, binds to the 23S RNA found in the 50S ribosomal subunit and inhibits peptide chain elongation. This binding results in release of the peptidyl tRNA. Bacteria become resistant by producing enzymes that alter the erythromycin so that it can no longer interfere with protein synthesis. Several types of antibiotics inhibit bacterial protein synthesis. The 70S
Okay, erythromycin may be discussed in macrolides class of the antibiotics. There is another. So tetracycline, how the resistance against tetracycline develop in the bacteria? Only in efflux pump. Actually, they were describing only the efflux pump, but we discussed three mechanisms: efflux pump, protein is bind with the target of the tetracycline, and third one, enzyme inactivation of tetracycline. So there's another important lecture video where you can have an overview of all the three classes: tetracycline, glycyrrhizocycline, and aminoglycosides.
This is Paul Eckberg from the Division of Infectious Diseases at Stanford University. In this video, we will discuss two antibacterial classes of protein synthesis inhibitors, the tetracyclines and the aminoglycosides. The other protein synthesis inhibitors are discussed in part two of the video. The learning objectives for this video include: describe how the various protein synthesis inhibitors differ with regard to the mechanism of action and resistance. List the key adverse effects of the tetracycline class. Recognize that aminoglycoside use is limited by the adverse effects and need for serum level monitoring. And explain the ribosomal protection resistance mechanism unique to this particular class of antibiotics. This overview will focus on the protein synthesis inhibitors depicted here by the antibiotics that target the 30S or 50S ribosomal subunits. You will see that this group of antibacterial compounds is very diverse, containing a number of different antibiotic classes. We will focus on the commonly used systemic antibiotics used in routine clinical care. In this part one video of protein synthesis inhibitors, we will cover the tetracycline class, seen here targeting the 30S ribosomal subunit in the and the aminoglycoside class, which is not pictured here. Please watch the part two video to learn more about the classes that target the 50S subunit. In order to understand the mechanisms of action of the various bacterial protein synthesis inhibitors, you must remember the basics of protein synthesis, namely translation.